For those that have been coming for the past couple of weeks at least, you'll know that we are in the midst, literally we've just passed the halfway point of an 8-week series looking at sin. We've been looking at what the Christian church has referred to as the seven deadly sins. And like I mentioned, right now, we're halfway through. And particularly if this is your first time, just want to say that we're talking about sin and the nature of sin, not because we want to be fixated on rules or regulations or falling into line, but because we are concerned as Christians about life and about life being lived to the fullest and as life was meant to be lived. We care about relationships, we care about human flourishing, and sin has a way of just poking holes in healthy relationships and draining the vitality out of a potentially wholesome and full lives. Joy can just leak out of our lives due to these holes that are poked there by sin. So it's quite possible to miss out on the good life that God has for his children because of our sin. The Apostle Peter, he puts it kind of bluntly in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. He says that sin wages war against our souls, that there's a campaign, that there's strategies and plans, all that goes into waging a warfare. Well, sin is waging war against your soul. And so the hope with this series is that we can have our defenses up and then also, by God's grace, be launching some counterattacks so we could be winning the war against our souls. Sin wrecks relationships and keeps us from God. And so because of that, we hate sin. Because of that, we want to hate sin. Maybe I should say it like that way. We want to hate sin. And if we see it as that which is at war against us, as that which is draining the vitality from our lives, then I believe that will help us to see it as the enemy that it is. This week's sin that we're looking at is lust. Lust. So that means that as fun as last week was talking about greed, you ain't seen nothing yet because we're going to talk about sex now. So we talk about money and sex and other taboo subjects. But again, they're things that Scripture is not silent on. And I believe money and sex can be used for God's glory and for human flourishing, but they also can be misused into a destructive force in our lives and in society at large. So I know I prayed for the kids earlier, but let's pause again and let's pray for us that we might have open minds, open hearts, and open Bibles. So yes, Lord, as we are looking at a subject that the world around us can't stop talking about, and Lord, perhaps for some of us that we can't stop thinking about, Lord, I pray that our ears would be open to hear from you on such a topic. Lord, in and of ourselves, Lord, we are just deficient and unable to stand against any temptation. But Lord, we do know that empowered by you, Lord, that we can have the whole and the free life that you've called us towards and created us for. So I pray that by the help of the Holy Spirit, by the example and empowering of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you would help us to look at this, Lord, and Father, that you would grant victory over this area, which has been such a stumbling point for so many for so long. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so the bulk of our time, or a lot of our time, is going to be spent in Genesis chapter 39. So as I make some kind of preparatory comments, maybe you could be finding your way towards Genesis 39. Genesis being the first book in the Bible, it's quite early in the Bible. So the order of this series I actually wanted to be quite clear about not starting the Seven Deadly Sins series with lust. I didn't want that to be the very first sin that is addressed, because sometimes it is the first sin that we think of, and then it becomes the only sin that we think of. I especially remember, my days as a brand new Christian in youth group with a bunch of, you know, horny teenagers and people who cared about us and cared for us, having them check in on us and ask us questions and maybe put a hand on our shoulder and look earnestly at us and say, "How you doing with sin?" And I knew, you know, we knew what they meant, and they knew what they meant, and then we'd say either, "Yeah, doing good with sin this week," or "Not doing good with sin that week." And what they weren't asking is, "How's the pride of your heart?" Or, "Are you dealing with envy this week?" Or, "Is there sinful anger in you?" Sin just was code word for lust in its various teenage expressions. And so that's kind of as far as the conversation ever got. And so I wanted to make sure that as we addressed lust, I think it'd be foolish to skip it, but also would be foolish to pretend that that is the only thing that people deal with. However, lust is a, like I mentioned, a big stumbling block for so many and for so long. The New Testament book of 1 Thessalonians, Paul tells us about what God's plan for your life is. God's plan for your life is laid out in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 3 to 5. You can flip there if you want, or you could just listen as I tell you what God's plan for your life is. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3 says, "This is the will of God." Your ears perk up. What's God's will for my life? This is God's will for your life. Your sanctification. That you abstain from sexual immorality. That each of you would know how to control his own body in holiness and honor. Not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. Now often that question of what is God's will for my life generally has to do with what career path will I take, or what country will I live in, or what city is going to be my home. And the Bible, you know, I believe God cares about those things and has a will for your life. But before we get to those specifics, the first thing is that God wants you to be sanctified, to be in a process of being brought from unholiness towards holiness. That's what sanctification means. And then he also gets more specific and says that you abstain from sexual immorality. And he says that you control your body in holiness and honor, not in the passion of lust. And so often for this whole series, I'm trying at the beginning of each sermon to define what the sin is. And I often find it's kind of hard to define what they are. You kind of like feel them rather than speak about them. But here, I think Paul in Thessalonians basically says that it's the opposite of holiness and it's the opposite of honor. He lays those two aside. You're either living your possessing your body in holiness and honor, or in the passion of lust. So lust is the opposite of holiness, the opposite of honor. So, as I said, I don't think that lust is necessarily, you know, the worst of these seven deadly sins, but I will say it's probably the most popular. We're dealing with it not because it's the deepest pit of no return, but it's because it's a very wide path. It's like a, you know, multi-carriage, you know, a dual carriage. What's it called? I call it a freeway where I'm from. But, it's a multi-lane freeway, dual carriageway, whatever, where lots of people traverse back and forth. And so I try to define the sin first, but then also find a story in the Bible that describes it. And, you know, when I was putting this together, I was thinking like, well, there's so many. It's not where can I find a story of lust in Scripture, but which story am I going to do? And so I was thinking, you know, of Samson and Delilah, a story of a strong man, both physically and spiritually, brought to weakness due to his lust. Or David and Bathsheba, one of the more famous passages about lust and abuse of power and all that kind of stuff that we see in the Old Testament. But we did that recently. I was thinking maybe of Amnon and Tamar, which is an even more perverse story of lust and abuse of power and all that sort of thing. But we did that even more recently, thinking of the men of Sodom. But I was also thinking of the story of, you know, Joseph and Potiphar's wife in Genesis 39. And if you have your Bibles open, that's where we're there. And the reason why I picked this as opposed to the other narratives about lust is that this is pretty much the only one that has a happy ending. This is the only one that ends well. And if you're familiar, I'm going to read it, but you're going to see that this chapter actually ends with Joseph being lied about and thrown in prison for a number of years. But that, I believe, is better than all the other endings where people give in to lust and then see their lives destroyed from the inside out. We're going to see at the end that Joseph's outward circumstances change, but his walk with the Lord is just as strong at the end than it is at the beginning. So starting at the beginning, I'm going to read the whole passage, so get comfortable. Now, Joseph is one of the 12 sons of his dad, Jacob. He was the favorite son of his dad. The other brothers could tell there was this rivalry, there was envy, and that envy led into an act of violence, and then even with him being sold to Egyptian slave traders. And so Joseph, going from the favorite son of his wealthy father, is, I guess, turned into human traffic, crossed over a national border, and then ends up on the slave market in Egypt. And that's where the story begins. Now, Joseph had been brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, had bought him from the Ishmaelites, who brought him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man, and he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had, in house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge, and because of him, he had no concern about anything except for the food that he ate. Now Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. And after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater than the house that I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except yourself, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And then he spoke to Joseph day after day, and he would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. But one day, when he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment and said, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled out of the house, she called to the men of her household and said to them, "See, he has brought among us a Hebrew to laugh at us. He came in to me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And as soon as I heard that I lifted up my voice, and as soon as he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled and got up out of the house." And then she laid up his garment with her until his master came home. And then she told him the same story. Verse 19. We'll skip. And then as soon as his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, "This is the way your servant treated me," his anger was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. And the keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed. So this is the word of the Lord. So as I mentioned, Joseph was doing well, then things went bad. But then now we see in chapter 39, things are on the upswing for him. He ends up in a wealthy man's house, and because there's that phrase over and over and over again that the Lord was with Joseph, God's blessings just kind of were all around Joseph's life. The things that he put his hands to, they succeeded. And so because of that, Potiphar trusted him with more and more responsibility, and eventually he's kind of promoted to second in command of all of this, probably vast household. And he's in charge of all this stuff. So his career is doing well, but then lust enters into his life and then causes some problems. So lust enters into his life, not through his doing, but through something acting upon him. It's entered into your lives, I'm sure, either by your initiative or someone else's, or likely a combination of the two. So it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. And how we deal with lust is going to make us, or it's going to break us. So with these passages in front of us, with this chapter, there's four things I want to talk about. Number one, why lust is an issue. Then we see a bad example of dealing with lust and a good example of dealing with lust, and then some takeaways for us. So number one, why is lust an issue? Is sexual sin still something that we should be spending time talking about or thinking about in 2015? Is there anything even left to call a sexual sin anymore? Or is everything a choice or a lifestyle or a preference or a compulsion or a yet unnamed orientation? Seems that by and large, we've lost vocabulary to speak about sexual sin. The very idea that there's such a thing as a sexual sin is mocked, and I believe will be mocked more in the culture around us. We live in a day, an age, a time, and a place that celebrates sex without boundaries. And wouldn't it be nice, wouldn't it be easy to just go along with the flow? Maybe like yourself, as we're discussing our Christian faith with our friends or relatives or just peers, the conversation can go so well until they begin to ask, well, what do you believe about sex? Or any variation of that question. And it can go from a friendly conversation to all of a sudden it looks like you are just this anachronistic dinosaur, this relic from some bygone religious era, before the electric light bulb, before the combustion engine, and you're just this historical aberration that somehow has survived until 2015. Am I the only one that feels that way sometimes? And everyone coughs because I guess. But I would say that, a concern with what we're calling lust, a concern with sexuality gone crazy, it's not something that only the Puritans of old were concerned with, or the Desert Fathers, you know, wrote poetry about long, long ago. It's not just like the religious inclinations of celibate bishops and priests in Rome. I believe that a concern about unfettered sexuality is from God himself towards the people whom he made. Boundaries have been given for our good and our flourishing. God warns us through scripture in many ways, through Old Testament writings, like this passage and the others that I mentioned, and even more direct directions given in books like the Proverbs and Job and elsewhere, against the dangers of, as I mentioned, inordinate sexual desire expressed in the wrong ways. But of course, the Lord Jesus himself, God incarnate, in his incarnation, and in his most famous sermon ever, we call it the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus addresses his hearers and us about the danger of this. Matthew 5:27 says that you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. Addressing, you know, an outward restriction on a sexual expression. He says, you know, you've heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. He says, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, well then tear it out and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than your whole body go into hell. Now, Jesus is using exaggerated language to say, guys, like, it is so important. If it costs you, like, anything, it's so important that we avoid this sort of thing. So he takes it from the external to the internal, and then he works his way out to the external again. Did you notice that? It's not just what you do with your body, it's what you do with your soul. But then he says, what you do with your soul is more important than anything that you do with your body. And so Jesus says, this is radically important. And so, if people think, oh yeah, like you're like a relic from the 50s, you could say, no, go back older. A relic from Jesus's teaching, God in flesh has spoken about this, and I want to take him seriously. And so he warns against lust here and elsewhere. So, again, let's try to define it. So what is lust not? I don't believe, and I think it's important, that we don't equate lust with ordinary sexual desire. In our story, in Genesis 39, verse 9, we see that when Potiphar's wife first speaks to Joseph and propositions him, or makes him an offer, a command, actually, in verse 9, he doesn't say this. Listen to what he doesn't say. He doesn't say, I can't do this because it's sexual. That's not what he says. He says, nope. Verse 9 says, I can't do this because this is wicked, because you aren't my wife. That's what he's saying. He's not, yeah. It's not sexuality that Joseph is trying to avoid here. It's sexuality out of bounds. Sexuality is a gift from God. Genesis chapter 2 speaks about God creating humanity and creating humanity male and female. He tells them and us to be fruitful and to multiply. And he says that that is very good. And God designed human anatomy in such a way that it is potentially life-giving, that it is pleasure-provoking, and that he does it in such a way that it's not necessarily only for babies, because it doesn't work for babies every time. You can talk to your parents more about details. But he creates men and women different, complementary, in such a way that he says that for you to be fruitful and multiply is a good, good thing. So here we see that there is the design in nature itself, and God created humanity, that sex is not negative, but that it is something God-given and to be used appropriately. Proverbs chapter 5 is a chapter, it's a book of wisdom in general, and chapter 5 really speaks about the wrong and the right ways for sexuality to be expressed. And so I would advise, I'd encourage you to read Proverbs 5 in its entirety sometime during this week. The first half, basically, is a father speaking to his son, warning him against adultery, warning him against using sexuality out of bounds. That's the first half. And the second half talks to him about using sexuality in the proper place. In fact, he commands his son to rejoice in the wife of your youth, to be intoxicated with her love. He commends healthy sexual expression. He says, let her breasts fill you at all times with delight. I had to practice saying that at the house. To be like, can I say it without? Okay. You guys nervous? I'm nervous. I'm trying not to be nervous. But... So there, we're all nervous together, okay? But... In the New Testament, 1 Corinthians 7, the Apostle Paul has a chapter that largely addresses sexual issues. And in there, he commands married couples to not go too long between having sex. He's like, you should be doing this. He's like, there's reasons for not doing it. You know, like if you want to, you know, for prayer or fasting or whatever. But he's like, but make sure it's not too long. Paul says that healthy marriages have regular sex. It's been said, I don't know who said it, I couldn't track down the source of the quote. But that, as we see that there's the proper and the improper boundaries for sexual expression designed by God for human flourishing, that Satan's plan is to encourage unmarried people to have as much sex as possible. And his plan is to encourage married people to have as little sex as possible. So let's do what we can, single and married people, to foil his plots, okay? And then as you know, just as much as fire has a proper place in my house and your house, if you have a fireplace, I messed up. Fire is great if it's in a fireplace. If fire is not in a fireplace, it's very dangerous to the household. I believe we're supposed to understand sexual expression in that same category. So as we're speaking about lust, maybe not just think that it's just sexual desire in general. The Bible is not sex negative. It doesn't speak poorly of sex. I believe it elevates and speaks highly of sexuality as something that's important, as something that is powerful and precious. And so because of that, we ought to treat with care, not treat it lightly. So to restate, lust is not a healthy, natural, God-given sexual desire. We're not trying to call evil something that God calls good. And we're not trying to reject or return a good gift that God has given to humanity. So what is lust? It's not regular sexual desires. It is an inordinate desire for somebody or something. Inordinate. That means out of order. That means that it's placed first when it should be, you know, second or third or fourth. That it's more important than it ought to be. The word lust, if you look it up in a dictionary, it doesn't necessarily even have to do with sex or sexuality. You can lust for other things. If you are familiar with the social network or the app of Instagram, you may have noticed hashtag wanderlust or wanderlust. There's 9 million photos that are tagged with wanderlust. Wanderlust means you just can't sit still. You just gotta go travel. You gotta go be somewhere beautiful. You want to travel and wander a whole lot. You know, we could speak about bloodlust, Personally, I'd rather have wanderlust than bloodlust. But the idea is wanting it so, so very bad. The Greek word in the New Testament is epithumia, which means over desire. So thumia is desire. Epithumia means over desire of something. Again, it's a desire that's inordinate. It's way too much. It's jumping the queue and it's in front of everything else. There's bloodlust, there's having a lust for life, there's whatever. But so here we see that it could be a lot of things, but applied to sexuality, it's dangerous. And so in our chapter, in chapter 39, we do see sexual desire just out of control in Potiphar's wife. Epithumia, over. It's the priority that we see in this chapter describing this part of her life. So she propositions him. And after she's told no, she continues her pursuit. So she keeps pressuring him. And if you see verse 10, it says day after day. So an epithumia, an over desire. It's not like, well, I asked, he said no, okay, whatever. But it's like, I'm going to keep on trying. And so she, you know, goes against the will of Joseph. She goes against her own common sense. Surely for her to get caught doing this, she'll face shame and probably punishment if she's caught. I gotta admit, I'm not up to date on like ancient Egyptian marital customs. I don't know. I kind of know stuff about the Hebrew culture, but Egypt, I don't really know. So I don't know, but it's probably not good. So she's at a great kind of risk to herself, or to, at least to her reputation in this. So she places herself at risk in order to satisfy her lust. She risks something important and secure in order to experience something temporary and fleeting. And that is what lust does. It causes us to rearrange our priorities and to make stupid decisions based on short-term gain. So she has a good thing going, and she's willing to throw it all away, potentially, for something temporary. In Hebrews chapter 12, we read about somebody else who did this, a guy by the name of Esau. And in Hebrews 12, verse 15, it says, "See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled, that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that afterward, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no chance to repent, although he sought it with tears." So focusing on verse 16, it says, no one, be sure that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. So if you read the passage in Genesis and the other passage, you'll read it, and there are no sexual undertones to that story. You know, Esau comes home from a hunt. He is really tired and hungry. He meets his, you know, skinny twin brother and says, "Hey, I'm hungry." And his brother says, "If you give me the birthright, if you give me, you know, the promise of the inheritance, if you allow me to be the patriarch of the family, not you, then I'll give you this lentil stew that I have." And Esau is like, "Whatever, that's fine. Just give it to me. I'm hungry now." And so he exchanges his birthright, his inheritance, the patriarchal role of the family, all for a short-term meal. And so as we read the New Testament describing that, it says, don't be sexually immoral like Esau was when he traded a great privilege, a long-term benefit, for a short-term bodily appetite being assuaged. And so again, like, I read the Old Testament over and over. I'm like, are we meant to see some like sexual innuendo? Not at all. No, we're just meant to see that's a picture of what this looks like. Trading something great, trading an honor, a gift, a privilege from your father for something that is going to last just a short period of time. Speaking of appetites, people do speak about our sex drive just as an appetite like any other appetite. You know, we get thirsty, so we drink something. We are hungry, so we eat something. We get aroused, so we're just find some way to alleviate that pressure. I would say it seems naive to compare our sexual drive with just every other appetite. Because in these days, there's, I think, literally no other appetite that is enlarged as much as this appetite that is being fed and nurtured, and then also is being pressured and encouraged. It's a driving force in society and all of life. C.S. Lewis wrote about an imaginary culture. He's like, imagine you're going to a different country or a different planet, and as you're looking around, you notice that there is this fixation on food, that, you know, people are constantly looking at photographs of food, that, you know, maybe college dorms have pictures of waffles on the fridge. People stay up late and they download pictures or videos of food being made, and they watch it, or even go into a club where, you know, food is passed around and touched, you know. He's like, if you were to imagine a planet or a culture where that takes place, you would say, well, you know, that desire to eat food is maybe an ordinary or good desire, but they are nurturing that to an unhealthy degree. And of course, his point in that, he has a great imagination, but he's not just imagining for imagining's sake. He wants us to maybe look at our own culture as if we were visitors. And if we would see, you know, a healthy desire for sexual intimacy being turned into something that's just the overarching meta-narrative or the dominant story of our culture, that's weird. So we should see our world as a little bit weird. I know we were born into it, but it's weird. So I think that's the case for us. We're a society that's not starving. Again, he's like saying, imagine, like, you'd think that those people obsessed with food, they might be starving, but he says they're not starving. They have all the food they could eat, but they just want more. They want to look at it. I don't think we're starving for sex, but we're completely oversaturated. Advertisements, marketing, all has to do with feeding into or capitalizing on our desire for sexuality. And that's taking what lust is. It's taking a normal desire, and then it's raising it up against every other thing. Again, epithumia, over-desire. So it's an over-desire for a good thing, but also, more than that, though, it's also a desire for something that's out of bounds. So it doesn't mean that every possible imaginative desire that you can have, you could say, well, it's good for me to desire that, just not so much. Well, sometimes there are such things as out-of-bounds desires as well. That's, you know, coming back to verse 9 and this thing, that's, Joseph says, you know, the desire or the option that's being presented to me, it's not that now is not the time. He says, you're not the person. You know, you are married to someone else. You are engaged, you are committed to another relationship, a lifelong relationship with Potiphar, not with me. I am not available, and you are not available to me. So he's saying it's not that sex is bad, but it belongs in a certain context. Again, like a fire in a fireplace, not on a couch. So according to the Bible, sex does have a specific purpose. It's designed to cultivate and signify the relationship between two people that says, I belong to you and to no one else. Sex symbolizes that, but I also believe that it cultivates that as well. It's a symbol for intimacy and commitment, and it's an act of intimacy and commitment. And if you're using sex for any other purpose, in actuality or in your imagination, then you're wrenching sex from its God-designed and engineered purpose. It's not just about bodies fitting together or about physical appetites being satisfied, but it's about our souls. Two people coming together and being united. Sex says that what we're doing right now, not right now, what we're doing with our body, is the scripture calls it one flesh. He says that one flesh relationship, I want that to be true of all of our lives, one flesh. You know, as the Sophia and Stephen song says, all of you and all of me. And so what lust does is it drives a wedge between bodies and souls. It abstracts or it blurs the lines between appetites and real eternal identities. It subtracts bodies from who we are. Again, good old C.S. Lewis. He wrote a whole book about the four loves, so I'm quoting him a lot. C.S. Lewis says that sex apart from marriage is its intimacy without commitment, which he compares back to food. He says that it's like eating food, but then vomiting it up. You want the taste of food, but you don't want the consequences of eating it. You want to appreciate the taste, but you don't want it to become part of who you are. And unfortunately, we don't have to imagine what that looks like. It's a disease or a mental illness among us called bulimia nervosa. And it's something that is from the inside out, from the trachea, from the back of the teeth, and from a lot of other rays. It has consequences on the body that are inevitable and that are destructive. And if we can see that in a physical sense, well then, what happens to our soul when we give over to lust without the commitment and safety that marriage provides could have a ravaging spiritual effect as well. Eating away, becoming less rather than more. And I believe this is just what's happening with Potiphar's wife. Her lust ravages her. She fixates on Joseph as a body, not as a will, not as a person who ought to be listened to, but a means of pleasure rather than a person. So her interest in him is purely based on his potential benefit to her. We know this for a couple reasons. It says in verse 8, Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. Form means body, appearance means face. So he was easy on the eyes. So there's that. However, it's not just that he was a good-looking person. It's because we see that this love or this desire that she had for him, it quickly turns to a hatred for him. As soon as she either gets what she wants or, in her case, realizes that she's not going to get what she wants, her love turns to hate, where she's willing in verses basically 11 to 20. The whole second half of the story is her being willing to sacrifice her integrity, her truthfulness, in order to damage him and get him far away from her. We see the same thing in that terrible story of Amnon and Tamar in 2 Samuel chapter 13, where there is a lust, you know, that Amnon has for his sister Tamar. And it says that he just fantasizes and lusts and eventually takes advantage and violates her. And then there's a sad verse that says, but then the love that he had for her was nothing compared to the hate that he felt for her afterwards. Just a sign that is the opposite of love, that lust is based on taking, whereas love is based on giving. So lust abstracts pleasure from a person. In love, you care about the person and the pleasure is secondary. But in lust, you care about the pleasure primarily and the person is secondary, or negotiable, or interchangeable, or doesn't even need to be real. Can be pixels, can be ink on a page, can be an imagination. So love gives, lust takes. We see this even in the heart of God, don't we? John 3:16 says that God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And so if anyone's calling anything love but involves taking rather than giving, then we know that that is the opposite of the heart of God. That is the opposite of God's definition of self-giving love. So we see some more negative examples here. We see that this woman, dominated by lust, I guess maybe something to point out, this is a woman. Generally, we think of this as a men's issue, and it is, but it is not only a men's issue. It's an equal opportunity offender. It will take all people, not from birth to death, but there's kind of a prime area, age, median age, but of any gender. And you know, I think advertisers are copying on to what the Bible is showing us here, that lust can grab the attention of females as well as males. And so we're seeing an increase in adverts that are, you know, aimed towards the female lust. Of course, the bestseller 50 Shades of Grey was not targeted towards a predominantly male audience, was it? So here we see this woman dominated by lust, constantly thinking about it. Verse 7 says that she cast her eyes on Joseph. Just think of if any of you are fishermen or women, fishers, you know, you cast. And what's the point of casting? You want it to go out and you want it to hook. And so she cast her eyes on him. She just contemplates his sexual attractiveness. She doesn't just notice him, but there's this meditation on it. Her thought life was filled with Joseph, and she had probably, in her mind, taken him to bed so many times already that eventually she just has to do it in real life. Thomas Aquinas writes about lust a lot in his writings. And in his writings, he kind of has this formula. He says that lust begins by looking, then it moves to mulling over, then enjoyment, then internal consent, and then final action. So looking, mulling over, enjoying, internal consent, and final action. Now, you know, for me, I don't know if it always happens that exact order, you know, like first one, then two, then three. But I guess the idea is that it begins internally, and then when opportunity presents itself, then it goes outside. And whether we can, you know, argue about like Aquinas's numbers of three, you know, but we see this in Potiphar's wife. We see that it begins by casting the eye and then mulling over. We see this with King David as he first, you know, looks at Bathsheba, and then his eyes is fixed and he stays. The same thing with Amnon and Tamar. Allow me to read you James chapter 1, which speaks about this principle. James 1:14 says, each person is tempted when he's lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death. So we see that there is this looking, mulling, thinking, acting, and then life and then death, James says. And then we see with this woman that we see that her desire is like that. It's growing. It's not diminishing. It's not that it runs out of steam, but in fact, it grows and grows and grows. Verse 10, like I said, day by day. So she's propositioning him over and over. There's a constant nature to her pursuit. She doesn't just neutrally consider something and then allow it to stay dormant. Her imagination of sin is not static. It's always trying to take more and more. It's like growing and expanding, and its influence is continuing. It's like an empire that keeps conquering smaller nations around it. And John Owen says that we're either killing sin or sin is killing you. It's not a matter of just peaceful coexistence. One is expanding and the other is decreasing. And as James 1:14 seems to say, that sin leads to other things. And so it is with her lust. In 13 to 20, you know, I guess she was hoping that it would begin in her mind and then end with an actual, you know, adulterous affair. That didn't happen because Joseph turned her down. But then it leads to, I guess, her feeling humiliated after being rejected, you know, some kind of self-loathing or whatever. And then quickly that turns into a hatred of Joseph, which leads to lies about the event, a slander of Joseph's character, and could have ended in his death. You know, she's accusing this person of attempted rape and of a, you know, especially someone in this, such a high-ranking family, that surely would have been a death penalty. But we see, for a variety of reasons, people have different theories why he is sent to prison rather than to the gallows. But so lust has taken root in her heart, but then there's fruit that shows up in other areas of her life. And, you know, these seven deadlies, as we call them, the seven deadly sins, you know, they've been highlighted because they often lead to others. They're often like the first door in a hallway full of doors. And so lust begins lies and what essentially is attempted murder. And so we see that, sadly. Wrapping it up. I have too much sermon, not enough time. So we see there's two characters. There's the bad character, the bad example of Potiphar's wife. And then we see there's Joseph. Joseph does what he can to avoid the temptation. Verse 10, look at it again. He resists and says no. Like, good job, Joseph. She spoke to Joseph day after day, and then he would not listen to her to lie beside her or to be with her. Even those last three words, he doesn't want to be with her. I imagine they must have a big house with a lot of rooms. That's just how I imagine it. And, you know, she comes in. He's like, well, I'm just going to take this elsewhere, and goes to a different wing of the house, doing what he can to not be in the same place with her, or at least not be in the same place alone. We see in verse 11, it says, one day it happened, which means there was other days where it didn't. And I believe that was Joseph trying his best to avoid this. And again, it didn't just happen. It wasn't just one-time opportunity, but he had to keep doing it day after day. So it's not a one-time event. It's a daily toil. As you or I struggle with sin in general, or perhaps lust specifically, this is not going to be a 100-meter dash. It's not just going to be run as fast as you can for a short period of time, but it's a marathon. It's a long, slow run that involves a day after day avoidance, a day after day set of structures and parameters. He controls where he is. He also controls his thoughts. Verse 9. So the first time she propositions him, he replies, he says, behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has not put anything, verse 9, but he is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except yourself, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Derek Kidner writes about verse 9. He says, by giving the proposition the right name, wickedness, and by relating it all to God, Joseph rooted his loyalty to his master deep enough to hold. So Joseph is willing to call her offer what it really was, which is wickedness, and by naming sin, sin. Again, that's one of the hearts of this Seven Deadly Sin series. We're talking about sin and how bad it is, and we're naming it as bad so that we stop domesticating it. You know, he says that's not just a compliment. That's not just an affair. He says, no, that's wickedness. So he doesn't give it a nice name. The second thing is that he thought about how this would affect other people. Sin in general, and lust specifically, tries to divorce itself from affecting others. Joseph here says, you know, this isn't just about me and you. There's an interconnectedness with this household. This would be ruining your marriage. This would be ruining, even selfishly, my relationship with my boss. I don't want to do this. And so as we struggle, as we deal, as we fight against sin, remind yourself, A, that it is sin, and then B, that we are connected one to another. But then ultimately, he relates it all to God. He says, I'm not just going to sin against you or sin against me or sin against my career. He says, I'm going to sin against God if I go against this. So if God really invented sex, if he really gave us the instruction manual, then we ought to think about him when we're faced with opportunities to use it in an unlawful manner. With long distance running or with any endurance sport, you do come to a point when you're so fatigued and so worn out that you're just ready to quit and stop. I know that at least four of you ran the Killarney Endurance Race yesterday. I know that at least one or two of ye ran the women's mini marathon last Sunday. So for some of you, at least six, you might understand what it's like to run so long and then come to the point where you're not finished yet, but you're about ready to throw in the towel. at that point, you need to remind yourself, why are you doing it? What is the point? What is the goal? Why is it worth it? After you've hit the proverbial wall, after your adrenal glands have given you all that they can, why are you still doing it? And so, we see here that Joseph is saying this thing, in essence, like, for me to do this would be a sin against God. And so that's why I'm not going to. And day after day after day, this kind of thinking was fresh in his mind, and that kept him from throwing in the towel, giving in, resisting temptation for a week and a half, and then eventually just going for it. So he has a motivation. Jesus gives us the motivation for purity. Jesus says in the same sermon that he says it's better to lose a part of your body than to give in to lust, he also gives a motivation. He says this, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." In such a visual-oriented sin, you know, Jesus says that you can have a greater vision. You can have something better to fix your eyes upon. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And then, of course, I'd be, you know, foolish not to point out verse 12 about how Joseph resists the temptation towards lust. He runs away. He just runs away. He gives up his coat and runs away, likely in undergarments or something like that, willing to be embarrassed rather than to give in to this. The Apostle Paul tells young Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:22, easy to memorize, 2 Timothy 2:22, flee youthful lusts. And so I can't help but think about, you know, Joseph fleeing, running away, just to get out of there. I was working on this series. I had a long layover in Amsterdam Airport about a month ago. And so I was like, had all my laptops out, and I'm kind of, well, I only have one laptop. Had all my stuff out, and I'm kind of just typing away and making the booklets that you guys have, some of you have, and trying to think of what are the verses that I'll be using for each sermon. And as you probably noticed, I got it wrong. I don't use these verses, but at least I use some of them. But I was reading, typing about this chapter, and then like this like Norwegian lady comes and sits right next to me and like asks me all these questions. And like laughs at all my jokes, and she's very interested in me, and I'm not that interesting. So, as I was like reading this about like, you know, like flee youthful lust, I'm like, you know, I'm done here. And so I just kind of like packed up all my stuff, and I was like, all right, it's been nice chatting with you, bye. And I just got on the travelator, and I'm just like, this might be what Joseph felt like. Probably not. His is probably a lot more drastic. But anyway, so I want you to take lust seriously. This is something that Cork City, this is something that, you know, your workplace, this is something that your campus smirks at and laughs at. I want us to be those people that take it very seriously. Jesus warned us plainly about it, and so woe to us if we treat lightly something that he takes seriously. And then also replace a deficient desire with a greater one. Joseph obviously had a deep relationship with God. Four different times it says that the Lord was with Joseph in that passage. And he is not willing, I suppose, to trade in the knowledge of God's presence with him, to be in the presence alone with this woman. So replace the deficient desire with a greater one. May we just get it deep into our brains that blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And then remember that God will be with you. God will be with you as we deal with temptation, as we triumph, as we fall. God is with us. God cares about us. God loves us. Now, in conclusion, again, preachers do this all the time. We say in conclusion, but we don't mean it. It's just to hold your attention for a few extra minutes. In conclusion, for the last time, you know, we might think, and you know, I'm kind of addressing this sermon to like the Josephs, you know, like I'm assuming I feel like I'm Joseph and you're all Josephs and we're just good people. We're just trying to avoid the Potiphar's wives of the world. But you know, like I'm Potiphar's wife. You're Potiphar's wife too. Like, we're not just the goodies, like, we're the baddies as well. What if we identify more with the antagonist than the protagonist in this story? Let me tell you the good news. God welcomes sinners. The genealogy of Jesus. Matthew chapter 1 tells us about the human lineage of Christ and his DNA before he came into the world. In it, we read about Tamar, a woman who pretended to be a prostitute. We read about Rahab, who made her profession in that profession. We read about David, a man who I've already mentioned was someone who was temporarily, at least, overtaken by lust and committed adultery and murder. And these are people who have been united to Christ. This is the line by which God brought the Messiah into the world. He brought healing to the world through sexually broken people. And if you are united to Christ, not by DNA, not by lineage, but by faith, then God says that he can heal you, that he can cleanse you, that he can use you as an instrument to bring and to show Christ into the world. John's gospel has the story of chapter 8 of a woman caught in sexual sin, a Potiphar's wife type person. And as the religious leaders are gathered around, ready to kill her, Jesus says those famous words, "Neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more." He calls sin, sin. He doesn't gloss over it, but he says, "I'm not going to stone you to death for that." He came to take the stones of condemnation that were meant for her, that were meant for me, that were meant for you, and to take them into himself. He says to every sexually immoral person in this room, at this pulpit, that he does not condemn, because he will be condemned on our behalf. He takes the punishment, he takes the shame that's due to her for her sin, and then says, "There's no condemnation left for you. Neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more." So perhaps today Jesus would say to you, who's been listening to this whole sermon and just sinking into your seat and wishing that you weren't here, I believe the Lord would say, "I do not condemn you. If you come to me in faith, asking for forgiveness and cleansing, go and sin no more." And just as much as the Lord was with Joseph, the Lord will be with you. "I will not lead you into temptation, but I will deliver you from evil." Let's pray. So, Lord, a huge topic, as usual. One that is uncomfortably close to the heart for many of us, I'm sure. Father, I pray that the sting or the crushing blow of condemnation would be spared us, Lord, that have particularly soft consciences or tender feelings or emotions that are a bit raw these days. Father, I thank you that those that are in Christ will experience no condemnation. Lord, I pray for those that could be outside of Christ right now, Lord, that wonderful, gracious, and kind Savior who reaches his hand out for those trapped or caught in immorality, Lord, that his nail-pierced hand would be extending towards us right now, Lord. I pray that, Lord, people would be taking his hand in faith, Lord, for forgiveness, but also for cleansing, for grace, but also for empowering, for no condemnation, but also for the ability to sin no more. Thank you that you promise to be with us even more than you were with Joseph. So I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.